Hello and welcome everyone to our Neumont University broadcast. I am Josh Krebs. I'm one of the CS faculty here at Neumont University. And today we have the opportunity to speak to one of my all-time favorite grads. How you doing, buddy?
Doing good. That sounds all official-like.
Yeah, it's, well, being one of my favorites is an official title, if you were wondering.
Oh, I should get that on a plaque, like put it next to my desk now.
Krebs. So tell our audience, first, let's just start with your name. Who are you?
All right, well, I'm Anthony Corbin from Saginaw, Michigan, originally, and I'm a Neumont alumni. Now I'm working off at Google in, well, San Francisco / Sunnyvale, California.
And when did you graduate from Neumont, and with what major?
Oh, what year was that? It was 2 years ago? No, 1 year ago. I think it was last year. I believe it was last year with a bachelor's in game development and computer science.
And so you're currently working at Google. What is your current job title?
I am a software engineer. Generic title. So I'm a software engineer level 3.
Awesome. Excellent. And so it's been a year since graduation. You got this really swanky job at Google. What have you done with the last year?
Learned a lot more. So after moving out to California, I actually got married to my now wife. Because we graduated, we moved out, we got hitched, went on a quick honeymoon, and then we both started work out here in California. And then we've been doing a lot of work to get the student debts paid off and actually trying to learn how to have a work-life balance. So doing other stuff outside of, you know, just working and coding 24/7.
Excellent. Glad to hear it. Now, let's go back in time just a little bit. Why did you choose Neumont University? How did you hear about them and why did you choose them?
One of the big deciding factors was they had a cool looking pamphlet. Because they had like this, it was unique out of all these other college applications I had seen, because it was like this funky yellow color and they didn't have a square box, it was curved on the edge. And then the slightly more informed choice that I have is I had a friend who was a year ahead of me who went to Neumont as well, so he was able to recant some good experiences and give some actual experience. So that was the slightly more informed decision, but the brochure made a big difference too.
Now, before coming to Neumont, hang on a second. First of all, I recall having you as a student, and I remember you being actually extremely proficient. You were incredibly intelligent. You knew what you were doing. You knew what you were talking about. How much programming experience did you have prior to coming to Neumont?
I don't know if I was that intelligent or smart. I like to think that I was, but it depends on how you define it. I was actually talking with one of my coworkers today about this, about how you got started. When it was actually around sixth grade, I started tinkering with a calculator, you know, those TI-84 basic calculators. I made my first virus, so to speak, where I displayed a message and then, or I had a label, displayed the message, and then go to label. And it was a virus because it would just loop forever and break people's calculators. And that's kind of where I started, but I didn't actually touch real computer code until halfway through my junior year of high school. That's when I picked up a little bit of C++ and HTML. And that's when I really kind of started diving into it and finding out that I liked it.
How did you know then? I mean, you said that you talked to a friend, he informed you about his experience, and then now you've got a little bit of programming experience behind the scenes. But how did you know going into it that Neumont was the right choice for you?
I liked coding, and that was something that I had discovered, and I was looking for something in coding, because general college didn't really appeal to me. I wanted something more focused and tailored to what I wanted to do. And it was a huge part of it was actually my friend's experience, because he had gone in, he actually went into the game dev major as well. And he was talking up like, oh, look at these cool things I was doing. And he started showing me the cool examples of the projects he was doing, not just sitting and lecturing. Because that was something I couldn't stand from high school, is just sitting and like trying to consume information. Like it would go in one ear and out the other. I couldn't remember it half the time. But with hands-on and projects and doing things, like he was like, oh, you have this cool thing, this cool stuff to show. And it's actually like you're learning and doing cool things compared to sitting around being cool.
So, you know, I, being a faculty member here and an alumnus myself, I often tell people who are considering Neumont that it is an extremely challenging program that we put our students through. Would you agree with that statement?
It can, well, the core coursework, I don't think I had much of a problem with. It became challenging. It became extremely challenging because of all of the opportunities to push yourself. At least that was my experience. There were always opportunities where, all right, you could do this core requirement and get through and pass, or you can do these other cool things and push yourself and go to new levels and actually learn about stuff that's outside the classroom. So with all of that, my experience through Neumont was definitely very rigorous and tough, but it was because of the opportunities that were presented that I said yes to.
So then what would you say, for you personally, what was the greatest challenge that you faced while you were at Neumont?
Well, greatest challenge, probably developing better management skills, like time management skills, because of the different things. I kept saying yes to things, and those things started to pile up. Like, hey, do you want to do this? Yes, I'll do this. So that balancing that with normal classwork in order to not let it slip, and keeping that same energy, because I think near the end of Neumont, I was starting to get burned out more. So there's a much larger challenge to be like, stay motivated with all the things that I currently invested myself into, including classwork. Uh-oh. You're a frozen picture.
This stops. There we go. Okay, sorry, we had a little bit of a feed problem there for a second. I apologize. So for you, it was about time management. It was about you kept saying yes to a lot of things, and they would all pile up. And so then it became a question of how do you prioritize these things? How do you meet all of them? Can you meet all of them? Was that the greatest challenge that you faced then at Neumont?
I say yes tentatively, because Neumont was really challenging, but I thought all of it was achievable. So it's hard to qualify, hey, this was the most challenging thing that I overcome, because there were a lot of small challenges throughout as well and many triumphs. So I think the most overarching thing was that prioritization and time management, but still I wouldn't say that as like strong.
Well, that's an important distinction. Challenge, and I'm glad that you pointed that out. Challenging does not mean impossible. Challenging just means it's not easy, and that's okay. And most certainly, you rose to the challenge ultimately, I got to tell you.
It was fun.
So then, Neumont is proud of its project-based curricula, and I'm not even sure how many projects you worked on. Can you give us a ballpark figure of how many various projects you worked upon?
Depends on how large of a scope you call a project. Because a lot of the, even a lot of the smaller assignments I went through were mini projects, because they were, hey, you have this requirement to meet this requirement. And you could qualify that as a project as well, because there was a lot of autonomy in that. So if you're counting all of those, I have no idea how to give that any form of a number. But I think probably the big ones, I probably had like six large ones. Most of them were through game development, because we would have more of these overarching projects that you build an entire class around. So those are more the larger ones that I can reference to going, this is a singular large project.
Well, let's not worry about how many projects then. Okay. Let's move on to something a little bit more targeted. What would you say, in your estimation, was your favorite project that you worked upon?
The one that, it was an aspect of the game, and it was an aspect of the game engine we were developing. So in the game dev degree, we developed this game engine over a course of multiple classes. And probably my favorite project was the visual aspect of it, because when we started revamping how we displayed stuff on the screen, I was actually able to export parts of my core engine for other members in the class. And then supporting that core engine and then building on top of these new features, that was really fun, because it was like, hey, I wrote code and it's not just me using it. And then the stuff we were building on top of it, we added shadows, much more complex lighting, which were quite challenging, but fun to manipulate.
So when you were here at Neumont, you were taking all these myriad courses, did any of these classes stand out as particularly great? And if so, in your opinion, what made them great?
I really liked data structures and algorithms. I mean, I took all these really fancy game dev classes. I made Android apps, made a game engine, made pretty things on a screen. But my favorite of it all was probably data structures and algorithms, because it's so cool to take this piece of information and represent it in this binary and like programmatic format. Then you get to manipulate that data. And just like the different approaches and the style of thinking of things algorithmically. And it opened me up to a lot of larger problems than just, hey, we're trying to display something on the screen and we want to make it pretty for users. It was now, hey, you have this complex requirement and you need to make it compatible efficiently with a computer. So it was fun to talk to the computer about what do you want instead of a person, because it's easier to define that for a computer.
Excellent, excellent. And while you were at Neumont, how accessible would you say were the faculty and staff when you needed them?
Yes. yes. I think there are very few instances that I found the faculty not accessible. And it was mainly because I lived in the towers, and if I wanted to find someone at 9 p.m., there weren't really many faculty still in the towers. Because I like talking to people face-to-face. It works a lot faster than email or messaging, so I don't really have any good examples along those lines. So I'd always like go and knock someone's door down and be like, hey, I want to talk. And during normal business hours, I don't think I ever had a problem finding someone.
That's awesome. That's awesome. So so students are coming in, you know, they're getting, a lot of our students come from out of state. They live in the tower, like you were saying, which is our living facility right here on campus, or any of our several other off-campus student housing sites. Do you have any tips for incoming students regarding adjusting to being away from family and just getting used to the rigors of a Neumont life?
So I might be a bad example for this, because I started off in Michigan, and then me and my family, mainly my family, they hated the cold. So as soon as I graduated, we went to Arizona. So I kind of got an introduction to being away from home, except with my family. So I was able to have like two stages. Okay, leaving Michigan, now in a new spot, but I still had that family support. And then it was transitioning up to Neumont. So for me, it ended up being a pretty smooth ride, and I think a large part because of that. So sorry, experience really for providing helpful tips there.
No, that's absolutely perfect. That's excellent. When you were at Neumont, What was your most memorable experience? And feel free to get outside the academia of it all. What was your favorite, what was your most memorable experience, even if it was a social experience?
There's two that popped ahead. One, hiking up Lone Peak and with Coulter. So me and another student, we hiked up Lone Peak down in South Jordan, and we thought that we got really far. We thought pretty close to the top. Then all of a sudden, we're kind of winded. We're like, all right, we're way up here. And then this old guy with a walking stick comes up out of nowhere, and he's like, hey, how you guys doing? We're trying to get to the top, and we're like these two young college students, like running our way up a mountain, feeling pretty good about ourselves. And he's like, yeah, the top is still about 30 minutes out, and it gets way steeper. And we're like, what? We just did a vertical area. So yeah, that was very memorable because, you know, getting shown up by this older fellow hiking up a mountain, which was awesome for him, but then the other one that really pops to mind was actually going to GDC, the Game Developer Conference, which was an awesome experience. So I went out with quite a few other people from the game dev degree, the game dev degree, and we got to meet up with game developers, a lot of indie developers, and see some really cool tech out at GDC. And I got to network with quite a few really cool guys from different game companies, some of them larger names than others, but got some really good contacts out of it, and a couple people are still keeping in contact today.
That's marvelous to hear. And when you first started going to Neumont, what was, in fact, actually, let's kind of generalize it. When you were first choosing which college to go to, when you were first going into college, what was your mindset?
I didn't have the best decision-making skills then. I knew that I wanted to go to a college that wasn't going to be boring, and I wanted to go to a non-regular college. Because I knew too many people who'd went to just like your classic college and they kind of coasted. And I didn't want to do that. I wanted something that was going to be more interesting the entire way instead of sitting through boring gen eds every day. Also, I didn't want to stay in school forever because high school was, I didn't really like high school that much. I had a pretty good high school, but still the learning style didn't jive with me well. So I was looking for something that would change what I had experienced in high school, would hopefully get over quickly, and was doing something that I actually enjoyed doing. And Neumont kind of hit all three of those bullets. The downside was it wasn't anywhere near family, kind of out in the middle of nowhere. Like, it's Utah. I'd never think about Utah. it just seemed like a really weird state to go to, but turned out to be a pretty cool college.
And you know what? At the end of it, at the end of your Neumont adventure, you ended up at Google, which is not small. That's not small cookies, right?
A couple people have heard of them.
So at what point did you set your sights out on Google? Was that always the goal, or did that kind of evolve over time?
So I started out Neumont, and I had an arrogant phase, and that's kind of when it developed. That's when it started. Because I'd started at Neumont, there was a couple classes that made me feel good about myself. And I was like, oh, I want to have a six-figure job, like, right when I get out. And then I didn't really think about it much after that. But I think it was early on when I just started my Neumont career, I kind of went through that little bit of a cocky, arrogant phase and set that really high goal of like, hey, I want this nice high number. And that's kind of like the general goal I'm going for. But then I didn't think about it again consciously until like I was a senior and getting ready for graduating. But I think it kind of worked subconsciously, at least, but because it's like, hey, you have this really high goal. That's kind of like the general direction you're going for. So that might have helped push me along. But for the most part, I tried to not think about it. So that way, because I was focused with enough stuff, just learning and consuming as much as I could at Neumont.
So how did Neumont help you in your job search?
My job search was kind of weird, actually. I got contacted by, actually got contacted by Google initially. I got hit up by one of their sourcers, and that actually started my interview process through them. I think that my name initially came up to them because Google came out to Neumont, and I think my name was included in one of their, included in the pools when we did Tech Talks. So I think that might have been what started it, but I don't have that type of information. I just know they contacted me first. But in jobs that I was proactively seeking out, I sought one out via GDC. So I had a teacher provide an introduction to me to another game developer, and one thing led to another after we talked for a bit, and I went through their interview process as well. So that was so GDC and the teacher, that specific teacher, both kind of facilitated both going to GDC and saying, hey, set up this meeting and this communication. But then I kind of, actually had received my offer well before I graduated. That was about the time when I received an offer, about the time that I was planning on going like hardcore into searching for a job. So it kind of shortcut me.
So looking back on all of it then, and looking at where you are now, what kind of thoughts or advice do you have on how one might achieve long-term goals?
Depends on which long-term goals you want. So, because if you're talking about long-term career goals or long-term life goals?
Well, let's talk about college first. Let's just start there. When it comes to graduating college, what kind of insight do you have now that you wish you had had as a student?
I think there were moments that I think that I thought too hard about it, where I spent a lot of time planning and looking for the next step that was correct, instead of living a bit more in the moment and saying, hey, this is something that is available to me, I'm going to go for it. And it's something that I think in retrospect, it's something that, and many times I did well throughout my Neumont career because there were a lot of opportunities that popped up that weren't necessarily part of my original plan. But taking advantage of them led me into, like with tutoring and such, led me into an entirely new avenue that like accelerated me a ton, and I learned a ton through it. So there were also times that I would overthink a lot of things where, oh, I want to get to this goal, it's way out in the distance, and I would try to enumerate all of the steps to get there. And then that plan would never work because it was way too specific. So it would be disheartening when I would be like, all right, this is where I'm going to go. I have all these different individual goals. And then like the first three of them would fail utterly and I would go in a slightly different direction, but I would enjoy that path. But that's also kind of my personality as well. I like planning, enumerating out and planning those long-term goals didn't work out as well for me. I've set more, so now what I'm doing is setting more broad goals. Here's the area that I want to land in. But they're always more in flux based off of what's currently presented, which is not a good like advert, like just go with the wind.
But kind of what I hear you talking about is the idea that if you set into stone each piece of minutia, then when something goes askew, it's hard to adjust and it's hard to flex with unforeseen outcomes. Yeah. What you're talking about though is saying, okay, here's where I want to land. And if it's anywhere in this circle, I'm doing well. It doesn't have to be bullseye, but as long as I'm within these boundaries, then I'm where I need to be for the next part. Does that sound about accurate?
It also makes those goals much more achievable. Instead of saying, I want to hit this exact percentage, then it's more like, I want to hit this exact ballpark, which is much easier to hit and motivate yourself. Yeah. Also, I think all of this like should be prefaced with, this is something that works well for me. And I know some people who work really well with those enumerated goals, because for them it's like, hey, I have this locked on target. I'm going to hit this. It gives a much better focus. So definitely to each their own.
So how long have you been working at Google now? How long has that been?
It is a year and a half. No, somewhere between a year and a half now.
And what is a typical day for you like?
So I have two desks, one that's way down in Sunnyvale and one that's in San Francisco. The one in Sunnyvale is an hour and a half to 2 hour drive each way. But I got to hop onto a bus, take that nice long drive there and back. And then in San Francisco, it's just a 30-minute ride, which is so much nicer. That's one big piece of advice. Don't have a long commute time. It kills you. but once at work, it kind of normalizes out. I grab something to eat. I sit down in front of my computer. I go through code reviews, because we do that here, where I'm looking at other people's code and putting my feedback on it and addressing feedback that's on my code. And then there's normally some meetings sprinkled throughout there in order to have stuff for designing. There's lunch at lunchtime and lots of coding. And that's what's really nice. So there's meetings sprinkled throughout, but there's lots of coding. So
well, with the exception of possibly the lengthy commute time, what you described sounds pretty ordinary, you know, regarding most development jobs. And this might seem a little silly, but what makes working at Google so special?
I like the people I work with, but you can have good people anywhere. There's some cool shiny tech that you get to be introduced to. But really, it's another development job. I think there's a really positive atmosphere here, and I really like the people I work with. And the food is very nice. Is you have food, and I take advantage of that. That cuts down on my monthly bills. Those breakfasts and lunch are covered. But from a work perspective, I don't have experience with other companies, so I can't give more specific examples of differences between the two. But it seems like, hey, I go in, I code, I talk to my manager, I have workmates. Seems like a coding job.
Are you able to highlight what you like best about your job? Like, what's the number one thing that when you wake up in the morning you look forward to at your job?
We have software. We have like goals that we're trying to achieve, but I have a lot of autonomy on where do I want to go. This is something that interests me, that's towards our product goal. All right, go work on it. I really like that aspect, but actually probably just being able to talk to some of these really smart people around me, because, hey, I'm doing my normal coding shindig. It goes up for a code review and all of a sudden they point out something that's either like completely blind to me or, they get this great insight and it's just like, ooh, I learned something new. So. Still isn't a satisfying answer like, oh, I get to go and jump down a trampoline every day.
Well, not every day. Yeah.
Actually, I wonder if there is a trampoline. There might be a trampoline in one of our campuses.
One can hope. One can hope. So, all right. So, what kind of plans then do you have going forward? Like as we go into the future of the life of Anthony Corbin, what do you see for yourself? Where are you hoping to go?
So I'm looking to get out of California because it's really expensive here. Because I like more nature things. So I'm looking up Washington, Oregon area. If for moving. So that's one nice large goal. But also I want to travel more. And a lot of my goals right now are more life goals because work isn't stressful. I have good progress going at work and a decent trajectory. And hey, here's a couple easy, here's the next couple steps for quick promotion. And that's kind of a little bit more set in stone, so to speak. It's an easier thing to have as a background task. I know if the work that I'm ever doing right now gets to a point where I'm not learning or I don't feel like I'm progressing, that's really the only thing that I see that would make me look at a new job or a new position, because that's what keeps work interesting for me right now, is I'm learning something new and I'm doing something interesting. If that's ever not the case, then work will become more important in my life-term goals.
Can you pinpoint anything or maybe a couple things that that you gained from going to Neumont that prepared you to work at a place like Google?
Probably the interpersonal team skills is something that I think is not, it's hard to enumerate how it helped, but I definitely think that the constant exposure to working in teams and working with other people has helped a lot. Also, the fact that everything was project-based, because working here, there's not these specific guidelines that you can follow that tell you how to complete your goal. A lot of it is you have to go out and discover how to meet these goals, which is similar to what I remember from Neumont classes. Hey, here's some core technologies. Here's a project. Go make the two work together. And I experience a lot of that at work, where it's like, hey, we have all of these tools and these resources, and here's what we want to do. We think that these tools and these resources are going to work well for us. Go hook them together and make it work. So all of that code experience, I think, definitely helped, because most of my day isn't solving like super hard, deep, tricky questions. Most of it is getting code to work together, which is, you know, similar to a normal project. The hard problem isn't the main focus that you're going to be working on the entire time. It's the stuff around it in order to support it.
Yeah, and you know, going back to what you said earlier about working in group projects, for example, it kind of goes hand in hand with that principle of software. The main problem, the big focus that you're trying to achieve, it's not always about hitting that mark every single time. It's often about solving all the surrounding variables. And the surrounding variables sometimes are not the technology. Sometimes the surrounding variables are those individuals contributing to the code body, right?
Oh, yeah.
So, how, you know, you worked in groups at Neumont. It prepared you in some ways, like you said, it was hard to quantify, but it prepared you in some ways to work in a team setting out in the real world. How did you overcome difficult team dynamics? I mean, have you had to work on a team with someone that was hard to work with?
Yes, I have. And that's also been a really interesting experience. I had a couple experiences at Neumont with difficult teammates, people who were difficult to work with, or people that I simply didn't work well with. But I also was very fortunate in my Neumont career where those were smaller and isolated cases. And I think that those smaller things helped when I encountered kind of a larger one here at work. Because there was one guy that I was working with, and we just completely clashed heads. And it was actually one time I remember from your class when I had a teammate I was butting up against. I forget what you told me, but basically you said, suck it up and get through it and figure it out. In much nicer words. And it was... I'd remember that I'd gone to you and talked, and that was actually the first step that I was kind of forgetting in my instance where, well, I brought it up with my manager instead of just working everything through my head. And that really helped because I was able to lean back on my experience that I had with you in your class as like the prime example. Hey, I clashed heads. What made that better? And I was able to take inspiration from that and follow those same steps.
So when someone is working in a group project and they're clashing heads, what would make it better? Like, what advice would you give people who are working right now with a difficult group?
First off, don't keep it all in your own head and think about it, because that makes things worse. Your brain is terrible at simulating human interaction, and it always makes the situation worse. In the Neumont example, I went to a higher authority, not as a way to trash on the other person, but as a way to get advice. Because that's really the next best step, is realizing that it's a communication problem and you're not working well with someone. Not that the other person is a stupid idiot, because there's always something you can learn from other people. And most of the time, it's an issue where you're just not working well together, not that one party or the other has severely lacking skill. It's more the way those skills manifest themselves aren't cooperative immediately. And that's what happened in my case as well, where he's an awesome engineer, smart and great. He just works completely different from me, and we were clashing heads trying to actually micromanage each other too much. So at least that was my instance.
And let's be fair. I mean, not every group project has someone that's hard to work with. Not every group struggles to work together, right? I mean, you made friends while you were there.
At Neumont or at work?
Yeah. At Neumont.
Yeah. I actually have some really cool developers. Still keep touch with some of them today. A couple of them who've come over to Google as well. But I don't get to work with them in a team, sadly. I wish I could, but.
So how hard was it to make friends at Neumont? For example, sometimes people will remark that those of us who are really into technology and coding, sometimes we're often introverts. Did you find that you were surrounded by a lot of introverts? Was it hard to make friends while you were here?
It actually ended up being pretty natural. I went through a couple of friend groups while I was at Neumont, and a couple of them have stuck well beyond Neumont as well. I made friends with introverts over introverty things. There was a lot more common ground. The main thing is I am weird, and for as much game development and stuff I've done, I don't play that many games. So for me, not having as much game experience was probably the weirdest part about being at Neumont, because I couldn't talk about, playing on all these different consoles, because I didn't grow up doing that. But I bonded over people with talking about, these cool data abstractions. So there was always someone that I could talk to. And a couple of friends who are definitely still around, which reminds me, I need to meet up with one of them soon. Yeah.
So then it sounds like it wasn't very hard to get along with the culture that you were surrounded by.
I don't think so. It's a pretty accepting culture.
I know I've asked you a lot about your time here at Neumont, but I am kind of curious, especially as one of your former instructors, I am curious, is there anything you wished that you had learned while you were here at Neumont that you didn't?
And that's where my memory starts to blur, because it's trying to remember what did I pick up starting at work versus what did I pick up through Neumont. But one of the things that has stuck out more was more collaborative coding, because that's something that's a huge culture here. And it was also a huge culture shock when I hit it. Because in Neumont, you make a lot of projects, but they're all your projects and your code. When you do work in teams, a lot of times you kind of find your slice of the pie, and you work entirely on your slice of the pie. But here, because we have code reviews, you have at least two people looking over everything that's written, which slows things down, but I've learned so much about different design styles and different approaches to problems that I never would have thought of by myself simply because of different people from different backgrounds. But I also don't know if Neumont could pull that off because you're dealing with students who've gone through the same curriculum. And a lot of the cool things I've learned were from people who had completely different curriculums and different teaching that brought them to the point where they are now.
But. So when you were coming to Neumont, we talked about this a little bit ago, but when you were first coming to Neumont, you didn't necessarily have an exact bullseye in your mind of where you wanted to land. But over time, and when you were a senior, you kind of figured out that you wanted to see if you could get into Google. And you did. Have you found that your career, as it has been the last year, year and a half, have you found that career to be rewarding?
Yes and no. Because I've gone through a couple stages and phases, one where I felt like I didn't deserve it, and that didn't feel good. And then one where I think I felt I deserved it too much. That also didn't work out well. But now I think I'm getting more towards a happy middle of not having too big of a head and also not having too much self-doubt. And a lot of that's not comparing myself to other people as much. But that's a different topic. But with career fulfillment, I have a cool project I'm working on. Currently I'm learning and my code is getting better, and that is exciting for me. So right now, yes. But it's always, I had a strain of thought too. And it's just kind of like.
Well, you've been finding it rewarding in some ways because obviously you've been growing as a developer, and you also had a couple of periods of time where your level of deservedness did not match reality in some scope, right?
In one extreme or the other. And it's been getting that leveled out has been more what's made me happier at work, because so far work has been pretty stable. It's mainly been outside of work that's gone under more development, because Neumont was coding 24/7. Well, not quite 24/7. I had to sleep for an hour or two. But it was like coding all the time. But that's not the case out in the real world now. I actually have a time that I go home and I don't code when I'm at home. So that's actually probably been the largest adjustment. So work is fine. It's the life part that's been a little bit harder.
So looking back on all of it, when you were considering colleges and you chose Neumont, did you make the right choice?
If I could turn back time with my current knowledge, I would probably still choose Neumont because of the people that I got to meet through it and the experiences that I was able to gain. There's the information aspect of, like, I learned how to do all of these different things with code, which you theoretically could do out of textbooks and just on your own with different projects. But what I liked about and what really worked well for me at Neumont was having other people to help push me as well. And the people that I've met, like, for instance, yourself and numerous other teachers that I try to keep in contact with, but I'm terrible at. Those connections and those people, I think, really made Neumont worth it beyond just the education that I got. Because education is information.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, yesterday we just had commencement. We just had a bunch of seniors graduate and get their degrees and going out into the real world. What advice do you have for them?
Life is hard, and don't worry too much about it. And actually probably goes into the main thing that I've struggled with of going between both being big-headed and having a lot of self-doubt. Neither one of those helped me at all. They were very anti-productive. And if I could change anything, it would probably be to stop thinking about that. And because I feel like I would have gotten much farther. But I'm glad that's the thing that don't worry about. Where you fit in compared to other people, it doesn't matter. There's always going to be people better than you, people worse than you, and that doesn't change your abilities. You should always measure yourself based off of the person you were yesterday, not the person sitting next to you.
Excellent advice. And for those prospective students, those people who are considering enrolling in Neumont, what advice do you have for them?
So Neumont might not like me as much for this, but make sure that you like coding. And if you don't like coding and technology, then don't go to Neumont. Find out what you do like to do. Because I know some people who, they went through Neumont, they even got a job at the end of it, but it was just money in the bank and it wasn't making them happier. So that's my largest piece of advice is like and enjoy what you do. And I think Neumont's a great spot if you do like coding. There's some really cool people there, but make sure that you like what you're going to invest your career into.
Excellent advice, Mr. Corbin. And Anthony, thank you very much for your time today. We really appreciate it. You're an amazing guy.
All right. And thanks for having me.
Absolutely. For those of you who are curious about enrolling at Neumont, just a quick reminder, applying for acceptance, that needs to happen by March 27th. So please apply to admissions if you are interested in attending Neumont. And as always, if you have any questions, you can feel free to call us, email us, or visit our website at neumont.edu. Thank you guys very much and take care. Have a great day.